How do you do? Jen and Cam feel it would be unkind to present this program without a friendly word of warning. We are about to unfold our true crime podcast, a podcast of lifelong friends who seek to examine crimes which were committed without reckoning upon God. The discussion will be frank, and the subject matter will be of a grim and violent nature. I think it will thrill you. It might even horrify you. So, if there are young children listening, or if you feel unwilling to subject your nerves to such a strain, now is your chance to... Well, we've warned you.
Hi, Jen.
Hey, Cam, how are you?
I'm really pretty good today. It's Sunday.
It is Sunday, and it's Mother's Day in the UK. So happy Mother's Day.
I did not know that.
It is. Oh. So all our mothers in the UK, happy Mother's Day.
On today's day, but you won't hear this till Wednesday.
No, you won't. Okay. I hope you had a happy Mother's Day. I hope you were spoiled silly. And aww, only had to do one set of dishes.
Aw. Yeah. Well, Jen, I got a case for us.
Woo!
You ready?
Yep.
It's a humdinger. As they say, and when I say they, it's me. I say that. But anyway, here we go. So, you know, I had a hard time trying to start this because I don't know. So this morning it occurred to me, and I think we can all agree that we've all been angry at somebody or someone, and you think these evil things, and then you're like, no, that's not nice. Don't think that. But you never act on them. I wonder if those that act on them, that's the difference between being sane and insane, or maybe it was underlying all the time.
Okay.
Here we go. It's 1983, and we are at Kansas State University, where James Kraig Kahler, who goes by Craig, that's with the K, by the way, because it goes with Kraig Kahler, is studying to become an engineer. Kraig was a junior at the time that he was swept off his feet when he met a young lady named Karen Lee Hedrick, who was a freshman. Kraig was extremely bright. He excelled in school, always had. When he was offered a job in Colorado, he could not say no. But what was going to happen with the relationship? After 18 months of dating only, Kraig asked Karen the big question, and she, of course, said yes. Karen had to leave school to make this happen, but the couple seemed to be madly in love.
Now, the big question is marriage, correct?
It is marriage.
Okay.
It's not
just checking sure.
Do you want a new car?
Or, you know, will you wash my socks?
No.
Yeah. Okay.
No. It is marriage. The couple would welcome their first baby, named Emily, and Emily was followed by Lauren and son, Sean. In 1999, Kraig was offered a new job where he would become the director of utilities in Weatherford, Texas. The family makes the move, and it doesn't take too long for them to fit into their new community. Kraig was finding a lot of success in his new job, and he'd always been a good provider who worked hard for his family. Karen, now this is Texas, so you got to imagine this. That's how
they
I
care.
Imagine it. Karen is mixing it in with the town's upper echelon. She is, you know, heading up various clubs and organization, PTA mm-hmm. clubs, things like that. So they're all finding their little niche in the community and pretty much loving life there. From the outside, they seem to be the perfect family. But Jen, as we know, no one is perfect. It seems like Kraig liked all things a certain way. And by a certain way, I mean his way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He made the rules for not only the children, but for Karen as well.
He's in control.
Control. Right? Now,
freak.
Mm-hmm. What kind of rules, you ask? Mm-hmm. No one could call the home after 8 p.m.
Oh.
On a school night or on a weekend night. Hmm. Why is
That's
that?
That's hard to control.
It is. And one of Karen's friends who called, incidentally, when Karen answered the phone, she's like, I can't talk. I gotta go. And she was like, it's only like 8:10. Anyway, no one was allowed to call the home after 8 p.m. Now, this is because Karen and Kraig had to be in bed each night by 8:30 on the dot. And this is because each night at 8:30, the couple would have sex. every single night. Every night. Monday through Sunday at 8:30.
Wow. That's romantic.
And you make fun of me for going to bed each night at 8:30. But I really do just go to bed. So I am in bed at 8:30 as well, but for different reasons. Another rule was, I know, I'm a nerd.
I'm just laughing at this situation that is not a laughable situation.
No, not at all. Another rule was the reviewing of the receipts. Kraig would go over each and every single penny that was spent by Karen, from groceries to clothes to gas. Kraig would examine it all. And I mean, sit down and go over, okay, here's a receipt from Walmart. What's this? What's this? What's this?
What?
Every single penny. And even if it were the kids' clothes, shoes, it didn't matter. He wanted to know where every single penny went. Another little pitfall in their marriage was that Kraig, who was getting / demanding sex every day, wanted even more. Or should I say, another. Kraig wanted to bring in another woman into their marital bed, and Karen was adamant that she did not feel comfortable with that idea. There were some other little things that Karen had mentioned to friends in regards to things that he wanted and that she just did not feel comfortable doing. What that is, I don't know, and we're probably never going to know, and that's probably a good thing. About this time, Karen, she wanted a little freedom. She's getting older. The kids are older. She decides she wants to join a gym. Kraig says, that's fine, but you're paying for it. Now, Karen doesn't have a job, so she has to kind of scrimp and save and pay for the gym. Okay. Odd. At the gym, she meets a fitness instructor by the name of Sonny Reese, and the two of them become new besties. Over time, their friendship became closer, eventually turning into a romance.
So it's Sonny with an O and not with a U.
No, it's Sonny with a U. It's a female. Yeah, it's a female.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Pardon me for assuming.
I probably should have said that from the get-go, but it is Sonny Reese. Sonny, like sunny with a chance of rain.
Sunshine, yeah.
There you go. There's something a bit unusual about this extramarital affair, and just like most intimate relationships, the only ones who really know what's going on in the relationships are the ones involved. As we already know, there is always a little bit of truth to those rumors. You and I talk about that when we see things on the National Enquirer or TMZ, and we're like, I've heard that a few times, and then
there's a negative truth, and then the rest is all speculation.
There you go. So rumors were that Kraig was more than okay with this relationship.
Oh, sounds like he would be.
In fact, he was actually encouraging it. Oh, yeah, and he wanted to be in on it as well. As Sonny and Karen fall deeper in love, Kraig starts to not be okay with this. After all, he's not getting the attention, I guess. The old green-eyed monster moved in on Kraig. What better way to put an end to the affair than to accept a brand new job out of state and far away from Texas in good old, you ready? Columbia, Missouri. That's right, Columbia.
Yeah.
Right down the street. In Columbia, he would become the director of Columbia Water and Light. You know what to say, Jen. Out of sight, out of mind.
Unless absence makes the heart grow fonder.
I'm just going to say, unless you're in love and then they're always on your mind. Then I said in my script, but you just beat me to it. Then the absence makes the heart grow fonder or fungus, depending. That's what I always said. That's what I always said. Karen is extremely upset and tried to talk Kraig out of moving. But what Kraig says is what happens. Of course, that's how it's always been. Whatever he said went. The couple moves to Missouri, but instead of Karen and Sonny breaking up, the pair continue to talk. In fact, they would even visit, and all of this was leading them to grow even closer. When Kraig learns that the couple are still in touch, he flips out. You just hear the story so many times, it kind of gives me goosebumps because you just know this is not going to end well. That, and we have a true crime podcast, but we've heard the story how many times?
Character, same story.
Yep, different names, same story. Kraig starts to nose around and go through all of Karen's stuff. He keeps a close eye on everything she does, everywhere she goes, everything. He goes through her computer, her closet, and her purse. Whatever he wanted to do, he did. In fact, he would buy some high-tech equipment and have that, I guess, I don't know about computer stuff, but you do, and I'm sure people out there, spyware to get in there to see what's going on in her computer, to be alerted to, you know, emails coming in or things like that without her knowing. So fast forward, it is December 31st, 2008, when Kraig would place a phone call to Lynn Denton. Now, Lynn Denton is Karen's sister. Now, it seems that Kraig and Karen had returned to Weatherford, Texas, just for the holiday break. And of course, this was on New Year's Eve, being the 31st. They were invited to a party at one of their old friends' homes. When they arrived, Kraig realized Sonny was at the party, and he was furious. Now, Sonny and Karen picked up right where they had left off, laughing and having a good time. The couple were flirty and touchy, and Kraig, well, he did not like that. He did not like that too much. So he began to throw a big fit in front of everybody.
Jealous.
So Kraig took it upon himself to announce to the entire party, a houseful, that his wife Karen and Weatherford resident and physical trainer Sonny were having a full-blown love affair. The perfect life that Kraig had constructed and worked so hard on to convince all those around him that it was perfect was now very publicly not perfect. So Karen, with all of this, she knew that she could not do this, and she wanted a divorce. She wanted out. Kraig was devastated, and he started the process of trying to get her back. When that option is clearly not ever going to happen, The divorce proceedings begin to get nasty. Kraig is fighting at every turn, and soon that fighting turns into stalking. On March 16th, 2008, one of their fights escalate to the point of the police arriving and charging Kraig with third-degree assault. Here's the little story. There's assault, and then there's a bear hug. Bear with me on this, if you will. On March 16th, 2009, one of their fights escalate to the point of the police arriving and charging Kraig with third-degree assault. Kraig would claim he simply hugged her too hard, Jen, and that left bruises.
Yeah.
But Karen's story, of course, was quite different. Karen would tell officers, and this was her exact quote from the court docs, "He asked if he could sit by me. I got up and he followed me and he asked for a hug. I told him no, but he kept asking, insisting, coming toward me with his arms reaching out to me. I continued to say no and tried to leave the room. He blocked my exit attempts until I could shove past him. He continued to block my exit from the room, eventually cornering me against the cabinet. He held me from behind in a bear hug, and the struggle resulted in several scrapes and bruises." You with me, Steph?
Yeah.
March 16, 2009, a petition for an ex parte order of protection against her husband was filed, and she stated that she was very afraid of him. Again, this is Karen. Karen speaking. "Over time, it has become apparent that Kraig is controlling. I have learned along the way that he is capable of using force. The issues vary, but I figured out how to keep things from becoming ugly. When money was a problem, I wouldn't tell him about what things that she was purchasing, groceries, clothing, etc., cost. When it was about sex, I decided it was easier to give him what he wanted every night than to refuse. On the occasions I would refuse, he has been known to be forceful and mean."
Oh, gosh.
After this incident, Karen couldn't take it anymore and finally moved out of the family home, which really sends Kraig spinning. She would take the kids and move to a small house in another part of Columbia, Missouri. Now, here's where I have to interject. When you go through a divorce, usually unless it's amicable, both parties have to stay in the house. It could lead to desertion if not. So she was trying to stay there with the kids, making it, you know, easier on them. But with this, he became out of control. Somebody's going to get hurt. And she knew it. The darkness around Kraig begins to deepen. He was having trouble at work. And finally, in September, he was asked to resign. With nowhere to go, no money coming in, Kraig had no choice but to move back in with his parents. And I guess Kraig at work, it's always easy to look back and see signs and think, I should have said something. I should have done something. I guess he was bringing photo albums to work and he was showing coworkers, his boss, pictures of Karen and his family and saying, look what we had. Why would she ever leave me? She ruined what we had. It was perfect. All of that, you know, it's like a little tornado that's coming about.
Just getting obsessive.
Yes.
Hindsight 2020.
At 48 years old, Kraig's life was far from the perfect one he had so carefully carved out for himself. His bitterness just starts to simmer and he begins to isolate himself from his daughters, referring to them as little Karens. Kraig does manage to still talk to his son, Sean.
To the son, not the daughters, to the son. I get you.
Over Thanksgiving weekend, Karen's sister, Lynn, who I mentioned above, invited Karen, along with Sonny and the girls, to her house in Derby, Kansas, to celebrate. Sean would remain with Kraig for the day. The following day, Karen would pick up Sean from Kraig. The pickup went smooth, even though Karen had told friends she was worried for her safety. Karen, Sonny, and the kids would then go and visit Karen's grandmother in Burlingame, Kansas. So it was the kid's great-grandmother. So she had made this deal that, you know, I'm going to take the kids. We're going to go have Thanksgiving dinner with my sister. I'll pick up Sean early the next day. We're going to go down and see my grandmother. It was around 6 p.m., Saturday, November 29th, 2009, when Kraig Kahler arrived at the home of Karen's grandmother's house with a rifle in hand and a devastating plan. Kraig entered the home and shot Karen Kahler, age 44, her 89-year-old grandmother, Dorothy White, his 18-year-old daughter, Emily, and his 16-year-old daughter, Lauren.
Oh, Lord.
Karen, Dorothy, and Emily were transported to the hospital. Lauren had passed away on the scene. Karen and her daughter would die before making it to the hospital, and Dorothy White would last around 4 days before finally succumbing to her injuries. 10-year-old Sean and Kraig are nowhere to be found, because Sean was there with them too. Sean was not one of the people injured.
Sean was saved because he was a boy.
Officers are desperately searching for both of them near the area, and they finally find Sean safe at a neighbor's house. The young boy had made a run for it, barefoot, without a coat, to the neighbor's home, seeking help and getting them to call 911. Now, remember, this is November in the Midwest, so it's pretty darn
it's cold. Well,
almost December, actually. Kraig is still missing. Investigators are worried that Kraig will continue his rampage and try to hurt even more people that were close to him or Karen. A manhunt would take place, and it would be 13 hours before they find Kraig Kahler and bring him in. When they locate him the following morning, Kraig simply looks at the officer and says, "I'm the guy you're looking for." On his person, Kraig had a holstered revolver as well as some long pocket knives. He also had hundreds of dollars in cash, pliers, gloves, a flashlight, mesh hunting bag, along with some food. Obviously, he was going to go camping and hide
out. Off the grid.
Kraig would be charged with first-degree premeditated murder, a capital crime worthy of the death sentence. When the sheriff's deputies were allowed to get into Kraig's red Ford Explorer the day after the family was murdered, they found a rifle box with a caliber size engraved on its side, the same caliber of casing that was discovered at the murder scene. During his preliminary trial, Kraig would enter a plea of insanity. This would be the only way to avoid the death penalty in the state of Kansas. According to law.cornell.edu, generally speaking, criminal insanity is understood as a mental defect or disease that makes it impossible for a defendant to understand their actions or to understand that their actions were wrong. A defendant found to be criminally insane can assert an insanity defense. Defense attorney Tom Haney is out to prove his client's obsession with his wife's relationship with Sonny Reese and the pending divorce is what drove him to become insane. All of the relationship that his beloved wife Karen had with Sonny drove him to literally become insane. And that would be his defense.
The relationship that he approved of at first until he couldn't join in.
The defense would claim that Karen's affair and disruption of his life and marriage caused a mental break. They would also state that since Kraig did not try to cover up the crime, it was not premeditated, but a crime of passion. I disagree there, and I think most people would. If you load up the car with ammunition and guns and you take a little drive, I would say that's premeditated. The prosecution would argue that Kraig knew exactly what he was doing. Kraig had packed his vehicle with items that would allow him to live out in the wilderness for as long as he needed. He also had a lot of cash. Prosecutors would say that he had packed his car knowingly that he was about to murder his entire family and then run away. This was a clear indication it was premeditated.
Yeah, I mean, there's no other way to say that it was a spur of the moment thing.
And I think this is really the point that brings it home. If Kraig really had a mental break with reality, if he really didn't understand what he was doing or what was going on, Sean, his son, would have been killed too. They believe Sean was left alive on purpose, as you stated earlier.
Because he was a boy. Yeah. The girls died for their mother's sin in his eyes.
There's no words. I don't even know.
I can't handle. I don't get the slaughtering of your own children.
Sonny Reese, who's 42 at the time of the trial, took the stand and described Kraig's marriage as very abusive. The abuse apparently was escalating to such a degree that Sonny refused to remove herself from an involvement with Karen after her friends begged her to do so. And this came about after that party where he really lost it in front of everybody. Pretty much everybody said, Sonny, you got to get out. Like, and I was honestly, Sonny was not harmed, but I was surprised. I thought for sure he would have killed her too. And I just, because that typically is how that goes.
Right. I agree.
Sonny would testify that she did not break up the marriage, but she did want to be with Karen. She also stated that she encouraged Karen to divorce her husband, but only for her own safety. She would say that Kraig wanted to have a threesome, but that never happened. So I'm sure Kraig felt like, in his head, I bet he encouraged this, thinking he would get in on it, everything would be great. And then when it didn't, and he realized his wife really was happy and in love, that's when he lost everything.
Well, he felt he didn't have control over her anymore. Sonny lost control, literally and figuratively.
Sonny went on to say that Kraig at first consented to their sexual relationship. And he was fine with that. And that was all before that big blowout at the New Year's Eve party. She had said even leading up to that, when the two would get together, he'd come out and small talk with them. And he even once gave each of them a rose, which I find very strange. Like The Bachelor, isn't that what they do on The Bachelor?
I don't watch The Bachelor.
Here's a rose for you.
I guess that was his way of romancing both of them.
Up next, we have the defense. Defense attorney Haney would say, quote, to keep his marriage alive, he was willing to consent to a sexual relationship between his wife and Sonny.
Mm. That was nice of him.
Right? Keeping that marriage alive no matter what. Mm-hmm. Prosecutors played a recording for jurors, and this is heartbreaking, and I didn't listen to this, and I know I don't want to. It's okay. Prosecutors would play a recording for the jurors of an emergency call. Now, remember the great-grandmother, as older folks, you know, tend to do, and Camille, has a private security system installed. And one of that is the, I've fallen and I can't get up, the life alert.
Yep.
So when somebody broke into her house, it was immediately triggered to the security firm. The recording featured a young woman screaming, somebody's going to kill us. And in answer to the operator's statement, he's in the home. So as he was breaking in, they're hearing this all live.
Couldn't do that job. The operators, 911 operators, it's, God love them.
Awful. Sonny Reese would be the one that identified the voice as Lawrence and bowed her head as she was listening to, it was more than a half minute recording. That would be absolutely horrible. The only survivor, Sean, would also testify. Up on the stand, he says, my dad came through the door and shot my mom. When he was asked how he knew what happened, he said, I just heard her collapse on the floor from the shot. Mm. I caught a glimpse. I think she was holding her leg. Questioned by Kraig's attorney, Thomas Haney, Sean would say that he then ran outside. The first thing I did was duck down, and I went around the kitchen counter, and that's when I ran out the door. He explained that after going outside, he went to the front of the house, and he tried to get back in originally. As a little boy, is this heartbreaking or what?
It's horrible. To know that your dad is
killing your whole family. My first thought was to go in and get a phone, he said. So I was trying to find a way to get back in. I started opening the door and I saw my dad go by again, and then I closed it. He had testified that he heard one or two more shots and then ran to the neighbor's house, but nobody was home. Then he went to another nearby house in which he could see people inside. When they answered the door, I told them to call 911 because there'd been a shooting at Dorothy Wright's house. He said that once he calmed down, I told them my dad had shot my mom, sisters, and my great-grandma. Sean would go on to describe the gun that was used by his father as a rifle, and he'd only seen that once before when the family lived in Texas. The boy said he knew about guns because his dad had given him a rifle, and he recently shot a deer with his grandfather's rifle. So he was well aware of what a rifle was versus, I guess, a pistol or you know, at age 10.
Right. He knew.
On December 25th, 2011, after debating for 2 hours, Kraig did not blink as the jury denied the criminally insane plea and instead convicted him of capital murder, meaning the death penalty is back on the table. On October 11th, 2011, Kraig appeared for sentencing. This is the proper case to impose the death penalty, pointing to two aggravating circumstances that justified the death penalty. The aggravating circumstances were that more than one person was killed and that the four victims were murdered in a heinous, atrocious, or cruel manner, and therefore should be sentenced to death for the quadruple homicides of his family. Karen's sister Lynn, let me just preface this when the whole fact that if you even thought maybe, just a maybe he was a little criminally insane, this is going to, you're going to be like, oh, okay, yeah, he was not. He totally knew what he was doing. And this is just cruel. Karen's sister Lynn addressed the court with a victim impact statement, ending the statement at the end, you know, saying basically that she was happy that life is never going, it's never going to be okay, but at least she can move on. She ended the statement by saying she could finally go outside and enjoy the day. Being the control freak he is, Kraig could not keep his mouth shut and from the defense table mumbled, "A beautiful, sunny day outside." At this point, not really sure if this was a play on Karen's girlfriend's name, Sunny, but no doubt was left with yet another mumbling. As Lynn continued talking, she mentioned the final times that she was able to see her niece, Lauren, during a trip to Wichita. Kraig once again piped up with, "and with Sunny too," indicating that Sunny was on the trip with Lauren as well. Like, he just had to get that dig in.
Yep, always have to have the final word. He's obsessed with Sunny. That's,
obsessed. That's, yeah. I cannot believe he did not murder her as well. I really can't.
Shocked too. I'm surprised that she wasn't his main target. Maybe he thought she would be there too. I don't know.
Before the judge made the final decision to respect the jury's recommendation, two written statements by Sean were read to the jury. This is heartbreaking. This is Sean. At this time, Sean's 12, by the way. "I do not want my dad to receive the death penalty because it would be hard on my grandparents. And I do not want my whole family gone." How sad is that? Sean would not appear in court for the sentencing. Before the sentencing, defense attorney Tom Haney, once again, would point out that Kraig had no criminal history, and he was operating at this time under, quote, "extreme mental and emotional stress, and he had a severe mental illness impairing his ability to think and control his actions," end quote. I disagree. The lawyer would add that life in prison would be far worse for Kraig, who loved outdoor activities. Many witnesses throughout the trial would say that, you know, he was a gregarious guy that loved hunting and fishing and being outside. And so basically the defense attorney is saying this would be way worse than putting him to death. Making sure I guess not really knowing if his statement would have much of an impact, he made sure to tug at the heartstrings of the jurors, and he mentioned young Sean and stated, "Do you have mercy for him?" Because obviously Sean had just...
Well, Dad sure as hell didn't have mercy for Sean. And I mean, he saved his life. Or didn't kill him, but still, he ruined Sean's life without thinking of him. Whatever.
Prosecution, all I can say is turnabout is fair play. And again, hoping to get to the jury's heart, Osage County Attorney Brandon Jones had the jurors listen to a recording. This gives me goosebumps again, like literally. Ugh. Listen to a recording of one of Kraig and Karen's daughters screaming for the help. She is panicking as Kraig was rampaging through the house hunting for his victims. In a horrifying exchange, you can hear Sheriff Deputy Nathan Perling speaking to the dying girl as she says, "I don't want to die." He literally was trying to comfort her as she is bleeding to death and dying. And she did die, as a matter of fact, right then and there. On August 25th, 2021, the judge would uphold the decision from the jury to send Kraig to the death penalty for murdering his entire family. Kraig and Karen's son, Sean, was left in the care of Karen's parents. Once again, always wanting the last word. Can you believe this? Kraig looks in the directions of his in-laws. They're the ones that are now in charge of raising Sean. And he says to them, "Take care of Sean so he's not raised by a bunch of freaks."
Jesus.
On March 23rd, 2020, the U.S. Supreme Court affirmed the capital murder conviction of James Kraig Kahler. Today, he is in El Dorado Correctional Facility in the state of Kansas, where he is awaiting a date to die. So I looked him up in there, and he's gotten in a few little scuffles, but nothing bad, like disobeying orders and things like that. So he's still alive. He's still there.
So far.
And I just have to say that he left.
He'll be there. They'll be alive for the next 20 years. So,
well, it's already been 10. It's already been 10, over 10. Yeah. So, yeah, he's probably got at least another 10 to go. He did spare Sean his life. But Sean, I mean, he lost his mom and both of his sisters and his great-grandmother.
He was a witness to all of that, too. So, Sean, poor kid. I guess he's a man now, rebuilding his life.
That's something you could never get over.
My heart goes out to him. It's got to be horrible. I don't even have words to say.
And then the guts, the cojones to look at the in-laws and say, make sure he's not raised by a bunch of freaks. Who's a freak, buddy? You're the odd man out here. Everybody else was doing just fine.
Well, he lost total control, so.
But in a sunny day, like getting those digs in,
Well, I don't know how I feel about the death penalty, but somebody who could slaughter their children in cold blood.
He was mad at them because of what the mom did, and the mom didn't do anything. She just happened to fall in love with somebody. Over yourself.
The children had nothing to do with it at all.
16
they
and 18.
They were just pawns.
Like, those are their babies, too.
Annoying. Horrible. Well, he's right where he needs to be.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. They got For that now. Right. So. Mm-hmm.
So that is the story of Kraig Kahler. Again, just because it looks perfect doesn't mean it is. Remember, you said that to me
right
before.
I always say that all the time.
When we were
just
talking about something.
There's Facebook perfect, and people only put the happy things on Facebook. People never put the drama that goes on into their life. They always put their new car. They never put the ones that just broke down before then. I mean, it's just...
I do, but that's me. Like, one of my coworkers was like, you're so funny that you're like truthful.
Yeah.
It's like my life. I don't know what to tell you.
I hardly ever post on Facebook anymore, so I don't know.
So that's my story there. What have you been watching? Anything new? Oh, I did want to give a really quick little shout out to one of our little besties, only because it was so so cute that she reached out to us this week. She is from San Diego. Her name is Crystal Ashley. I'm not going to say her last name, but she sends little screenshots of her watching the show. Now I sound like my 83-year-old mom that says, I didn't watch your podcast. Mom, you can't watch it. She is in San Diego, and she said she's told all her friends about us. So I just want to say thank you. And she was like, I want to get a big following down here in San Diego for you and Jen. I'm like, okay, I love you. Okay, I love you. That's it. So anyway, I just wanted to, and we don't do that very often, but I just wanted to say thank you. So anyway, what have you been watching? Anything?
Just started the HBO series Minx. M-I-N-X. I love it. I think it's really cute. It reminds me of Boogie Nights, but in the magazine business. I don't think it's for everyone, so, you know, there's nudity.
Do you want to tell the fine folks what you said to me yesterday when you sent me a note about it?
If you want to tell them, you can. Because it says more about you than it does about me.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Well, that's what you said. That's why I was just like, yep. To know me is to love me. What can I say?
Yeah, I told her she might want to watch it because there's a lot of male genitalia in there.
If you know, you know. Yeah.
So let's see. Did that. And then I am catching up on the second season of the Gemstones.
Oh, I haven't even started that. Ooh.
Yeah. Why can't I think of the first word that goes
righteous.
In front of it?
Righteous.
The righteous gemstone. It's a lot darker this season, but I like it. I love John Goodman, St. Louis's own John Goodman.
Yeah.
He's amazing in it.
Other
he
than
really
you and I
is.
And John Hamm, he's right up there. You know what I'm
he's
saying?
Right like the four St. Louis's best. But yeah, I watched those yesterday. So Minx is only 4 episodes in. I didn't know that when I started it. But I love it. It's set in the 70s.
Great clothes, I bet.
I wouldn't say great clothes, but it's very 70s clothes.
Yeah.
Set design, you know, all that kind of stuff that I love. My husband loves it for all the vintage cars that are all over.
Nice.
Yeah. And he's so funny because he collects Hot Wheels. That's like his big thing. Hot Wheels, Matchbox cars, that kind of thing. And so we're like, we'll watch show and he'll tell me what cars is what cars. And then Righteous Gemstones, we're watching this one scene and he's like, there's over $1 million worth of cars in this scene alone. Just the cars. It's not counting the jets and
HBO. So they have it.
It is HBO.
But they have the money.
They're good. I suggest if you've got the heart, look at Minx first, but it's really, it's good.
Oh,
it's about a feminist.
I'm gonna be checking it out today.
New 1970s feminist. She's trying to get this magazine done and nobody's buying it. Nobody wants to publish it for her until she finds the only one that does is a pornographer.
Oh.
And he wants to do the magazine, but it's like a playgirl type instead of a playboy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And she's like the really staunch feminist that, and she's stuck in her ways until she meets the lovable, you know,
sidekick character,
porno guy. Yeah. And it's the guy from The New Girl. I don't know his name. He's got the odd shaped nose.
I don't know. No.
He's cute. He's really cute. He plays the pornographer.
Okay.
But I'll be good. Checking that out. I really today. Like it. Even my husband was playing his video game and he stopped playing the video game to watch it. So
nice.
He really likes it. So good. There you go.
There you go.
That's cute.
There's your TV recommendation for the week.
Yeah. What about you? Have you been watching anything?
I finished Euphoria, which I love. There was mixed signals about that the second season. I purposely plugged my ear holes and did not want to hear any reviews. I didn't want to hear anything that happened, and I wanted to literally binge it top to bottom, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So,
mm-hmm.
And that's and I'm so glad I did, because I might not have liked it as much had I not done that. I love Zendaya.
Some controversy that season too.
It was good. It was good. I was very happy with it. So
my daughter loves it. My daughter absolutely
loves
Euphoria.
The older
one? No, the younger one.
Ooh, ooh, that's spicy for that
age. It is spicy, but she's a smart girl.
It's,
I trust her. So
it's something. Again, not
it
for
is
everybody.
Something. No, I watched the first season of it, and she discusses it with me. Mm-hmm. So we talk about it.
The thing about Pam, have you started that?
No, I have not.
I love it. Love it. Reese Witherspoon, I think. Oh, my gosh. She's so good.
Reese Witherspoon's in it?
I'm sorry. I keep saying that. I keep saying Reese instead of Renee Zellweger. I don't know. I keep doing that. I apologize.
I was going to say, what part
Renee
does
Zellweger.
Reese play?
I keep saying that. But see, the same reason that I really think she did great, one of my friends was like, I could not stand it. I thought it was nails on a chalkboard. And I was like, really? I get the exact opposite. I loved it. I thought she did a great job.
But I told you there is a radio morning show host here that's like, I hate the Pam character, and I couldn't figure out why I hated Renee's version of the character, and then it dawned on me, I hate her because she has the same hair that I do.
Yep.
And that's what it is. It's the hair.
That's funny.
So yeah, it made me laugh.
So yeah,
but no, I haven't started it yet.
It's good. There's the little nuances, which I just absolute, like the Polar Pop soda.
Yep.
And then I had to Google that, and then she's got a fat suit on. But she has her legs crossed with like culottes and like socks and tennis shoes. And the way she's like jiggling her foot, I don't know. It just cracked me
She's
up.
A Midwestern mom. That's the whole thing. Yeah, I was reading some posts and people are like, why does she always have a big soda? Mm-hmm. Why does she always have a big from the convenience store? And it's like, that's kind of how it was when they picked her up. Like, I think some of the police interrogation.
Mm-hmm.
Things she's got a great big soda with her,
soda
convenience
pop.
Store.
Channel 2, when they were covering it, Fox 2 News, they have her peeking out around the corner of, I think it was the garage, and she's got that in her hand. And Reese, not Reese, see, Renee said she saw that and loved it, so she wanted to put that in there. So
to keep having it,
yeah.
But yeah, from what I've heard, she always had a convenience store soda in her hand, so.
So check it out. It's good. All right. You got anything else you want to say, Jen?
I need to. No, I really should. I thought there was something that I wanted to talk about, but I can't.
Do you want to talk about the podcast festival that we will be in August?
Yes. In August, the 26th, we will be in Texas. Dallas, Texas, at the True Crime Podcast Festival. We will have a link in the show notes, but you can go to the True Crime podcastfestival.com, buy your tickets, and come see us and a bunch of other amazing podcasters that will be there.
It's going to be super fun. I'm just saying.
It's a lot of fun. It's been a long time since I've been to Dallas, too. Maybe.
Not me. I was just there a couple years ago. Really?
Yeah. Well, it was when I was working at a book fair company. And since there's only one, you can guess which one that is.
The big one.
The big one. The only one. Yeah, we went down there for a conference. It was fun. Texas is Dallas. A fun place.
I do. I like Texas, too. All right, Jen, that's really all I got. You want to say goodbye to the good people? Remember, lock your doors.
And keep passing by those open windows.
Bye-bye.
Love ya.
Today's episode was researched and written by me, Cam. For more information about this episode, as well as all the sources I used, please check out our show notes or the podcast website at ourtruecrimepodcast.com. Our True Crime Podcast is developed and created by hosts Jen and Cam. Original music and audio mix of all our True Crime Podcast episodes is courtesy of Nico Vertese from We Talk of Dreams. Listener discretion is provided by Edward October from October Pod VHS. Our True Crime Podcast is executive produced by Nico Vertese and Dick Vane. Make sure to like and subscribe to Our True Crime Podcast wherever you listen to your podcast. We can be reached on Instagram and Facebook at Our True Crime Podcast or on Twitter at Our True Crime Pod. You can email us at ourtruecrimepodcast@gmail.com. If you really like the show, make sure to check out our Patreon at Our True Crime Podcast. Our True Crime Podcast is an OTC production.
Craig took it upon himself to announce to the house full that his wife, Karen, and Weatherford, let me say that again. Weatherford's kind of a hard word to say. Just saying.
Weatherford. Weather.